everyone. My name is Sanjukta. I'm a third year PhD student in the Department of South Asian Languages and Civilizations. My research focuses on this particular North Indian city, Allahabad, and I'm looking at the history of the place in 19th and 20th century, and some of the debates I'm interested in are linguistic debates that were a large part of the political culture, the public culture of that place, and communal relationships in the early 20th century. And I'm trying to understand that there's a phrase that's used for Allahabad, which is Ganga Jamuni Tehzeeb, which means the synthesized culture of the two communities represented by the two rivers. So I'm interested in investigating that.
That's where the rivers meet.
Yeah, that's where the rivers meet, and there's a big pilgrimage.
The pilgrimage is very important. So, but what's the language issue in Allahabad?
I mean, you know, the Hindi and Urdu language issue, which sort of animated all of, or divided all of North India, was also, so I'm interested in not a sort of contrarian history, but a more assimilated history of the two languages in that site, and a sort of third language that emerged, which is Hindustani, and took some institutionalized form, and there were many nationalist leaders who tried to come up with a solution, since you know the language was such a language became such a highly divisive issue that finally led. I mean, it was a big part in the, I believe, in the partition.
And Allahabad remained a very important city, even though it wasn't the capital of UP.
That's
it was
true.
Still,
yeah, the capital moved after after independence. That's right.
So it's more exciting in history than today.
Yeah, it's a historical work. So after Chris Bailey, I think there hasn't been too much interest. So that is another reason to sort of reinvestigate. I mean, he's more of an economic and social historian. So I think my work will be more of a cultural history.
I think it's a great place.
Yeah.
I'm Karen. I'm a second year master's student at Harris, which is the School of Public Policy, and my research is kind of twofold. So the first part of it is researching the history of and the inception of the South Asian American civic identity in the country, because there was no real pan-ethnic, pan-religious, pan-linguistic South Asian American identity until around 9/11, when all of a sudden South Asian Americans were targeted by the state and by other Americans in the same way. So after 9/11, a bunch of coalitions were created and a bunch of different identification classifications were created, and 2001 is kind of when South Asian American became a real identity, because before that people identified as Indian American or Pakistani American or Bangladeshi American, but there was no South Asian American identity. So growing up in Iowa as, you know, one of very few Indians, I was really looking to find any community I could get, and so I became very invested in the South Asian American identity, and when I came to grad school I wanted to understand how that was formed and what the implications were, especially right now. Attacks on South Asian Americans are surpassing a level seen after 9/11, and hate crimes and hate violence against South Asian Americans is really at historic levels, so looking at what it means to be in solidarity with other South Asian Americans is something that's not studied very much, but I think it's very important in this time. But also before I came to grad school, I worked in New Delhi, which is where my family is from, and I did community organizing in the slums of New Delhi, so there's been a lot of development, especially around the metro in Delhi, but with that comes a lot of displacement and a lot of eviction. So just trying to advocate for the people who have been marginalized by development, and that's mostly low-caste people like Dalits and Muslims and low-income refugees who are sometimes the casualties of a larger march towards development and prosperity for India as a whole. So my research is kind of grounded in both America and in India, which is reflective of the fact that I grew up in both America and India.
So have you gotten involved in the South Asian community in Chicago?
Yes, I'm on a Chicago dance team, a South Asian dance team, and through that I've been able to meet South Asian Americans across the city who have come here like a year ago or whose families have been here for like three generations. And it's really interesting to see, even in Chicago, which is one of the biggest cities for South Asian Americans, the diversity of experience, because there's a lot of undocumented South Asian Americans, right? And when you think about our community, you don't think about that because there's a lot of stigma associated with it, but it is a huge part of the South Asian American community, and being aware of it is really, really important because you can't advocate for people you don't know even exist.
We need you at the Indo-American Center.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I have heard a lot about their work. I'm pretty involved with SALT and SAPRI's work.
Mm-hmm. The SAPRI, the South Asian American Policy Research Institute, mm-hmm. is a very important group of people in the Chicago community who really have tried to use social science to further the ends of the South Asian community as a whole. How far do you think that the kind of communal identity of the South Asians is based on mistaken confusion with Muslims?
I think a lot of it is, right? Because after 9/11, I firsthand experienced that, you know, being brown was enough to be a target. And in that moment, a lot of us felt like the right answer to something like, oh, is your dad like one of the terrorists who bombed the Twin Towers? Was to be like, no, I'm Hindu, I'm not Muslim, I'm not the person you're looking for. But it doesn't matter, right? Like, mm-hmm. we can see in Kansas, I think 2 years ago when Srinivas was killed, they didn't care that he was Hindu, they didn't care that he was Indian, they thought he was Muslim, he was Iranian, and they didn't stop to ask questions, right? So a lot of researchers have said it's something that's called a xenophobia and a chromophobic incarnation, more so than a particular focused religious incarnation, because no one's looking at your like identity papers, no one's looking at like your particular religious convictions, they just want to target you because of what you stand for.
No, that's really quite interesting and devastating kind of confusion. Not that people should be attacking Muslims either, but...
Right, I mean, the right answer to that question is not that I'm not Muslim, but it's that you shouldn't be targeting Muslims, you shouldn't be targeting anyone, but sometimes it's hard to make those arguments when these types of hatred are so deep-rooted.
In moments when people are really excited that...
Yeah.
And already bent on their own confusion.
Hi everyone, hi Stan. I'm Shodeep. I'm a PhD student at the Department of Statistics here. This is my fifth year and I'm going to graduate over the summer and I'll be moving away from Chicago. So yeah, it's been great working here at the IHouse, like working on different endeavors here. Regarding like I'm and Dave, when I first met a lot of people here, I came to know about IHouse for the first time at that time. And then I have been involved with IHouse for several other things like language tables and all these like supper clubs, movie things. Basically, I hail from a very small town in India. It's in the northern part of West Bengal. It's called Jalpaiguri. So coming to a big city like Chicago was a different experience for me altogether. And I have enjoyed it, really enjoyed it so far. My research focuses on, it's not as interesting as what their research is. It's pretty boring. I work on theoretical statistics, so mostly like developing methods on how to deal with data when there are time dependence or spatial dependence. So for example, one of my applied projects focus on brain signals where patients' EEG type data are obtained for different time points, and then based on that time points, we want to predict what type of disease or what type of conditions the patients have. That's the kind of temporal dependence I have been interested in, and more so I want to work on, and I have been working on spatial dependence, like dependence on different locations. And the most applied project and most important applied project I have worked on is air pollution. So pollution levels are always dependent on both space and time, like. This is neighboring locations always have affected the other positions' pollution to a high extent. I have worked on Taiwan's data and have tried to predict the pollution level for the next 20 years or so. So that's kind of more about my research. Yeah, not as interesting.
Yeah, that's very interesting.
Yeah. I didn't mention about the work that I've done here and with the community. I actually do not remember any longer how I heard about the IHouse or how I got involved, but last year I got involved formally as a fellow, and since then one of the initiatives that Shodeep and I have been jointly engaged in is the language table, and I think the language table really reflects the most practical aspect of my research, since it's a language table that offers, fellows, many of us from India, we meet every Tuesday or Wednesday, it's changed every quarter. And I know Hindi, Urdu, and Bengali, mm-hmm. and many of us are bilingual or trilingual. So the idea was not to offer these tables on a one-on-one basis, but also to form a community amongst ourselves. Mm-hmm. So it sort of started quite informally. We were like, oh, let's do this together. And now there are four or five of us who know these three languages, one or more. And the participants who we've had also have, you know, again, they come from a variety of backgrounds. One of them, one of the regular participants, she's a fluent Urdu speaker who was a foreign service officer and now is based in Pakistan. So, and now she is doing a PhD here at Harris. And another participant is an Indian American student who's a PhD student in economics. And so it's just been an amazing initiative, and we've had a wonderful time just meeting each other every week throughout the whole year now. And our conversations range from the mundane to very, very highly political issues, or sometimes, you know, it's about our everyday lives here. But yeah, so we've really found a very interesting community. And a lot of us as PhD students often end up meeting others who do similar work or are from similar departments or speak the same languages. So there was no way that I would be meeting people from Harris or, you know, somebody doing a PhD in statistics other than this forum.
I think about the discussions you mentioned last week, we started with this serious discussion about like political situations
That's
in India,
me.
And we ended up with watching movie trailers from for a Pakistan movie,
and then trying to figure out how we can go and watch that film in Niles or stream it somehow, maybe here. So
in other words, you're kind of continuing what the iHouse was in its previous operation.
Yeah, I it sort of all happened by sort of we didn't think of it as any kind of premeditated idea that we, but it really speaks about the space that these things came together in this wonderfully seemingly coincidental, but actually very, you know, planned ways, because there are people facilitating these situations where these conversations and encounters happen. So thank you.
I was going to say that my experience with the Bengali language table when I was a student in the 1950s was probably quite similar. And I learned a lot about politics in advance of my arrival. And I was talking about how interested Bengalis are in rituals, but they're just equally interested in politics. Maybe more. I can't say.
I'm the Bengali who's more interested in politics than performance.
But their politics is theatrical.
That's true. I agree.
The Calcutta is festooned with photographs of Mamata Banerjee, who was the chief minister of West Bengal, and who is, I'd say, the number one or number two nemesis of the Prime Minister of India. The rest of India is festooned with photographs of Modi Ji, the Prime Minister. It's a kind of a theatrical politics. And we're going to have some chocolate cake now.
And a toast
to Stanley D. Christensen, our benefactor, our friend, our the shy Norwegian who wouldn't come out to enjoy lunch with us, but to whom we're all very grateful.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Cheers.